Good morning. I heard you had a lot of great talks about MicroS, Cubic, and transaction updates the last days already. So we had to do a lot of changes in the last 3 years to make this great product things, from very small to very intrusive, very big. But the good thing is nobody noticed. Some people only now notice after 2 years the changes we made. So what we did worked fine and helped the people, but there is one big issue topic left, and these are configuration files in case you are doing an atomar update, atomic update, and that's what I want to speak about today. So my name is Thorsten Kuckuck, I'm distinguished engineer at SUSE. I'm also the senior architect responsible for SLES and MicroS. A little bit about the background. RPM configuration files. This is something for every distribution has, and RPM as standard has some support for configuration files. If you don't mark your configuration file as package var special, then it will, all the changes of the user will be overwritten with the next update. If you mark it as normal config file, and you make a change to your configuration file in the package, then the one from the user will be moved away as RPM safe and overwritten. If you marked it as config no replace, then the modified configuration from the RPM is stored as RPM new beside of it. So this hasn't changed for many, many years. So this sounds to me at the beginning, first glance, everything must be okay, else people would have changed it. But is it really everything okay? So after every update, you have to look for RPM safe and RPM new configuration files to get your services working again. And special thanks here for these people who continuously fix typos in comments in their configuration file, mark as config. It means after every update with a typo fix in a comment, my configuration file is moved away and I have the default one which is not working on my systems and I have to go through all the RPM safe and RPM new files to find out what has changed again, why is my service not coming up. So, and then you have to match all the changes manually. Luckily, most of the changes are not that important or really visible to the service, it's continued to working. But if you really didn't take care after every update, it could be that your service will be insecure, not work as expected, or something similar. Now we introduce atomic updates for OpenSUSE with transaction update. Other Linux solutions have other solutions for it. And that's even getting more worse. So atomic updates are either my update is applied fully, correctly, or not at all. There is no stage in between, like half of the RPM is currently updated, services are seeing it, whatever. If everything applies fine and there were no mistakes, you make an atomar switch to the new system and everything is there and running. And if something fails, you can do an easy rollback to the old version. What does it mean for configuration files? So we create a copy of the current system and update this. This includes the configuration files, of course. And this also means during the hidden update, we merge or adjust the configuration files with the new versions. Between this time and when the admin finally says, now it's a good point to activate all changes and reboots, he can do his own changes to configuration files. Which means you have, before reboot, visible configuration files with changes, and not visible, you have configuration files with changes done by us as Linux distributor or as package var or upstream software package, and they are going out of sync. If I reboot now, then all changes made by the admin to the visible one after applying the update are lost. So he has to manually find them and redo them again. And other problems are, how does the admin know that the where change is done, that the config changed in the background? How can he adjust them before they reboot? So we have a lot of open questions here. How to handle configuration files correctly in a case of an update? There's also something called factory reset of systemd. There was a blog about it. In the end, it means I can delete etc, and with the next reboot, everything will be recreated again, and the system is in the state as I deployed it without any changes. Some people like this idea, but now Linux distributor did implement it, most likely because it's not really trackable, it's a lot of work, it's a lot of changes to packages, whatever. I don't know exactly why. So this all together leads me then to the problem we are having today, which means most Linux distributions have a Linux distribution with Atomo updates. For example, it's OpenSUSE MicroOS for us. It's CoreOS, Fedora, Red Hat, Atomic or CoreOS. It's Ubuntu Core. So there are many, and they all have face the same problem, how to update the configuration files in etc. And they all did come up with their own solution. So, which means it's different on every Linux distribution. Which reminds me a little bit of the times before we had the file hierarchy standard, where on every Linux distribution, the configuration files, applications, everything was stored in another place, and the file system layout was completely different. So now, if you have a solution for a package for your distribution with Atomic updates, and if you speak to the upstream developers, they say, it's working for the user standard Linux distribution's desktop server, and for Atomic updates, everybody is doing something else, so I have to implement several ways every time for only one distribution, so they are not interested in it. So that makes it also pretty hard to come up or solve the problem for our product. So, and this is the goals I try to solve, or what have. So my goal is that independent on which Linux distribution you are using with Atomic updates, the user should always find the configuration file in the same place. As an example, most distributions with Atomic updates have their user database not in etc, there's only a dummy or for the user created one, but somewhere under user lib base system or something else. I very often got told CoreOS is much more secure than MicroOS because CoreOS has only one user and that is root. Besides that, I don't think that having only one account and everything is running as one account is really secure. It's not true too, and I always follow them where in user lib base system or base they can find the real passwd file. So this is always surprising for the people. They know it from one distribution, and the next is different, and the next is again different. So users should find the configuration in every distribution in the same location or with the same way that they know how to look for it. It should also create guidance for developers that they develop new software in a way that it works from the beginning with transactional update. Short to midterm, I want to have a solution for Atomic updates. So for a small set of packages only, like we use in OpenSUSE MicroOS. Long term, it would be good if we can do it for the whole distribution and not only for a few packages, and that it is really consistent across. So what I don't want to take the fear of some people, I always hear in talks about this, it should not become a requirement for all packages, and you should not start now to adjust all packages to follow to the new layout. If there is a package which has already a solution for this, like systemd, don't confuse people by moving everything around today. This is not helpful. If this is something people really like, it will come from alone. If not, then it doesn't really matter. And if we think about a solution, what are the requirements for it? The one I created in discussions with my team and other people are, it needs to be visible to the admin that configuration files got updated and that he maybe need to look at it. It must also be visible for the admin which are his own changes, so that he knows if he has to merge something, what he changed. And in the best case, it would be optimally if the changes would be merged automatically. Now I want to come to some proposals. We have different kind of configuration files that's why we need more than one proposal. We cannot do one for everything. And not for every problem we found a good solution yet. But if you look at the standard application configuration files, there is a good solution. Look at how systemd is doing it. Systemd has userlib systemd with the system distributor defaults. It has etc systemd where you can overwrite it. So you can copy the configuration file and adjust it from userlib to etc, and then your version is done, and you still have the unmodified original version in userlib. Or if you only want to overwrite one or two single values, and if it's possible with the format of the configuration file, you can create a .d directory and put only a file or several files in it, which overwrite a single option and not the whole file. This also helps you later to find out what did I change, because if you have a long file with, let's say, 100 options, it's hard to find out which you changed. But if you have 5 files, every file one option, then you immediately see what you did change really there. Look at the systemd unit manual page. There is a good example how this works like and how it could look like. So at the first glance, it looks like it's a lot of coding work. I have to touch every package, every software to implement it. That was my first impression when I started looking into these problems too. But if you take a closer look at OpenSUSE Tumbleweed in etc, you will find out it's not that much work, at least not for the core packages, because most core packages have already something built in, which is similar or also solves the problem, but we don't use it. For example, PEM, we have etc PEMD, we have userlib PEMD. Nobody knows about userlib PEMD. I'm, as one of the old Linux PEM maintainers, also meanwhile completely forgot that this directory exists and only found it out by accident when looking at another Linux distribution who is using it. So for PEM, we only need to adjust our packaging and we have it already for more or less free. This CTL, we also have already a lot of directories, userlib.ctl.d, etc.ctl.d. So packages could install their config file in userlib, not in etc, and the admin could overwrite our distribution-specific settings in etc and always sees what he changes and he always sees what our defaults are. ld-config is also something similar. We use etc ld-config.d, ld-config.d. We install our it's not configuration files in the real meaning, because no user will ever modify the files we install there. So in my opinion, they shouldn't be in etc if the admin never touches them, modifies them, or cannot even modify them. These are only some few examples. If you look at etc, you will find a lot of tools who have already .d directories, and I didn't check everything. Maybe they have already support for several ones, but if not, it should be easy to enhance them to support it. So the first goal we should look at is, what do our applications already support today to solve the update problem and enable it and adjust your packaging that we can do that? Another thing is, there are for nearly every language config files parsers, for Perl, Go, C, C++, Ruby, and most very few, but some of them already support the systemd-like setting too. For example, I found one written in Go, Go Ini. We also have somebody in my team currently working on a C implementation of a library, so there's only one config interface, and then the library in the backend is merging all the configuration files for the application. So that also helps a lot to adjust applications in an easy way and is not really intrusive there. Another different case are this, I call it system databases. These are not real, strictly spoken, no configuration files, but every system has them. ETC RPC, ETC services, ETC protocols. It's quite easy to move them to something under below user. And we also have NSS plugins which could look up at first in ETC, and if they don't find the entry there, look up in user. If they find the entry there, and if yes, use that. So that is really only a packaging thing. I used parse user fair defaults etc there because this parse, this directory is already used by Tumbleweed or was used by packages before I started looking into this. I know from discussions already that some people don't like it. I continue to use it in my slides because it's already there and used. But the directory is something we also still need to discuss. It's not optimal. For example, fetter or passvd entry is not system independent, so don't belong to fair. There could be other configuration files which are system depending, they don't belong to fair. So maybe user etc would something better, but more at the end. So etc passvd, etc group file, etc shadow file. To be honest, we didn't found a good solution yet. We made many proof of concepts. One was also a etc shadow.d directory, etc group.d directory. It's quite easy with NSS plugins that all applications can read this merge in without any change to the applications, only to the etc NSS switch configuration file. But every time if you then think about changing a password, creating a new user, it's really a huge amount of work to adjust all possible tools there. So the best we currently have, and if somebody has better ideas, I would be really happy to hear them. So create system accounts in user share, defaults, whatever. Normal accounts done by the user created in etc. This has a drawback. If the admin creates a system account, you can have again a UID clef because there could be already in the hidden file something. Use a NSS plugin to read them. This does not really solve all problems. NSS compat, still used by many people, wouldn't work anymore. And as I said with an example from CoreOS users, it's confusing if people don't see all passwords, all users in etc anymore. They need to know where to look for the real one and how to look it up. Default locations. I already said below user, we need a way where to store configuration files that people will find them. Currently, it's like pre-file system hierarchy standard times. Everybody has something else. So it should be easy to find for user and remember for system administrators. Best is all in one place. Don't clobber user lib even more. There are already so many files and directories in user lib that it's really hard to find something there anymore. Find a solution which does not conflict with the file system standard, or we need to adjust it. I'm afraid we need to adjust it, even if it is nearly dead. I hope that we can reactivate it, come to a conclusion there. The name of the directory should not confuse administrators, so they should know what it is. And it should be clear that this is the default location for distribution supported, supplied configuration files, and note that this is the configuration files where they have to edit the files. They still need to do it in etc. As I said, many Linux solutions have their own solution already. Here is a list of what different solutions use. Userfare default is what Clear Linux and several Tumbleweed packages are already using. Userfare base layout scale pem.decores is what's used by CoreOS Container Linux. Slash writeable, slash etc writeable is used by Ubuntu Core. User etc is used by OpenSSL, Red Hat and Fedora or CentOS Atomic. Userfare sysconfig was a suggestion. My currently biggest problem here is the share, because what do we do if applications people have something architecture-specific, then we cannot store it in share. Userfare MISC is already used, but I think using that would be even confuse people more, because the usage of what is used then and what is written in the file here standard is not really compatible. So that were my current favorites when I wrote the slides. Meanwhile, I'm not that sure anymore. I froze user defaults as top directory because it's already in use on OpenSUSE Tumbleweed. But we're thinking about passwd, password group, shadow. They don't really fit it. The idea was to move it to user libsys image etc. But that's really hard to find for people and even more confusing in different places. Meanwhile, I think maybe user etc would be the best choice as already used by Fedora, Red Hat and OpenSUSE, MicroS. But this is really something needs to be discussed in a broader round. And now I'm already at the end. There's a long more detailed proposal in my GitHub directory. I will also put the slides in there. So there is written much more of the background why some things are as they are or why things we tried already are not working. And are there now questions from you, suggestions, ideas? I'm happy about every feedback.
So what I take from your talk is primarily we need more modularity in configuration files. So the tools which need or create configuration files should already provide a way to provide some modularity. From my experience, that's also the way to go. So just two remarks. When we talked about authentication databases, passwd groups and so on, maybe the problem isn't that critical, because usually if you distinguish system accounts from, say, user accounts in a bigger infrastructure, the user accounts are not provided usually from local databases, but from a directory or whatever, for example, using SSSD. So maybe this would be a way to circumvent those problems you have mentioned.
Yes, that it's also an idea to store that in LDAP, whatever. That's also a reason why currently don't see it as critical to solve, because really, if you have more than one machine, you normally either have very few accounts or in a big network, you have something like LDAP, Active Directory, or whatever for this. The problem is really if the admin creates a user system account for his software he needs to install for it, and then there is a clef. The functions for it are not big, that's why currently we ignored it, but this is something we would like to solve in a generic way for everybody.
Okay. The second thing is I'm not that sure, but I'm also not an expert in that area, whether the existing PEMD files really solve the problem of modularity in PEM. Have you some experience on that? But maybe we could clarify this in a personal conversation.
Yes and no. So They don't really solve it if you have user libpem.d, but there is also the include directive. And with this, is it possible to solve it? Yes, it's not easy for the admin, but it's a first step.
Okay.
And I don't think that after, I would say the PEM development is that side many, many years, because Sun, who owned the protocol or the definition, doesn't exist even anymore, and nobody is willing to come up with a PEM version 2 or whatever, because they are SSSD whatever. So that is too much in use to really replace it. I think we need to go small steps to make it easier. One is already that the admin can override it and still see what we are doing. But yes, it's, as I said, not everything is solved with this. There are still minor or major issues open. But having a step, doing the first step, then the next one is much easier.
Okay, and I think the last question then is for a personal conversation. Have you ever found a way to set the default U mask in a modular way? I haven't, but we can clarify this in personal conversation.
Yes, I think that is a personal.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Yeah.
Have you also considered to change the way that password, group, and shadow are managed entirely? I mean, replacing the complete thing in a way?
So, as I said, we made several proof of concepts. There are ideas to store it in a database and have a daemon fetching it out of it. We are not really happy with all one. If somebody has a good idea doing something completely different, it's also fine. But there are some things to remember. One thing is there are two interfaces, which one which is reading it. It is an NSS interface of glibc. So everything for which you can provide an NSS plugin is fine to read it. The second thing is, and that is a big issue we always see, you have a lot of tools which modify the password, which modify the account, which make changes to it. And we were looking at to get accepted more easily by people is to find something that they don't feel they need to learn something completely new and have to touch 100 package applications and rewrite big parts of their code. So there are many options, there are many ideas. Nobody had the time to come up with a proof of concept which was really solving the issue and would be accepted by many people. If you have a good idea how to store it in another way which solves the problem, great. I'm really glad to, if you could tell it to us, if you can discuss it, I'm really open there. And there is no go, except we don't want to touch the current existing interfaces. More questions? Okay. So I will submit this the next days to the Open Source Factory mailing list and hope to get there more ideas, comments that we can start to make changes. Only so as feedback in this round, if you would say we start for OpenSUSE Tumbleweed modifying all applications, configuration files, would you support it? Would you help to move it? Do you think it's a good idea to move it, modularize it? Or do you think, no, I will not touch my packages, I will not help? So who would be in favor and help moving this forward, even with his packages or likes the idea? Only one, two? Okay, four. So the majority, so who doesn't care at all? Okay, less. So majority, you don't support it, you don't like it, or? Okay, nobody doesn't like it. So many people need to think more about it. Then I want to thank you for coming so early, and I hope to more longer fruitful discussions on the OpenSUSE Factory mailing list. Thanks.